Good morning. Good morning, web viewers, replay viewers. I might have a bit of a slow signal today. Hey, Mom, can you see the creek / stream / river? Water level's dropping pretty good. Good morning, and no makeup day today. Hey, Nina, Cindy. Yeah, it's still running pretty high. Look like I just rolled out of bed, which I did. Good morning. That's not true. I got up at 6. How's everybody doing? Excuse me. Excuse me for rubbing my face on camera. Natural is right. Don't hate me because I'm beautiful. Good morning, good morning. So, a bit of an interesting night with flooding. Schools are closed. We have two rivers close by, the Coosawattee and the Cardeque. And people who live along the banks of those rivers are being evacuated. Not forcibly evacuated yet. And they probably won't have to be, but they are being asked to leave. They expect those rivers to crest sometime this afternoon. It's not raining right now, so let's cross our fingers for that. And we'll see how it goes. You know, it is, but it's we're up high. So we're up on a pretty steep angle, so it won't get to us. And there's enough drainage under the little cabin that it didn't get up to that either. But it did, like, get to the bottom of our smoker. And I'd say up about 12 inches. Looking out there now where the water marks are, it's about 12 inches or so. About mid-calf. So we got up there. I was pretty nervous last night. Our bridge is still there. And the water is now... I don't know. It's our first winter here. I know flooding is pretty typical for Georgia in general, because my daughters lived here for a long time, and they typically have a lot of flooding in the spring and the fall, winter-ish. It's a lot of rain. Yeah. Yeah, I wasn't worried about the house last night, but I was worried about my husband trying to drive into here, into our little valley holler. Yeah, I was worried that our bridge was going to wash away because I didn't want to have to rebuild that, and it was really loud. Hi, Linda. Yeah, it's pretty sweet. So most of my anxiety came from not being too sure that my husband would follow. Would not try to risk driving through that water. He didn't, though. Yeah, it's pretty sweet. Instead, he walked in. So, that was pretty sweet. Pretty sweet of him to drag Rose all that way in the rain. Because he had to climb, like, up, over. He tried to cross at one of our neighbors down. But his road's been washed out completely. Like, he has no road to his house anymore. They don't live up here full time, so it's not a huge deal. It is, but it isn't. But our very next door neighbor is a single woman, and her road over the creek has big culvert pipes. So he was able to come down the mountain, cross her road, climb back up, get on our dirt road, and get home. So it's been an interesting day. And the water level's already dropping, so it rises quick. But it falls quick. This is pretty normal for Texas, too. It's just not at all normal for Colorado, where I've lived the last 25 years. Yeah. No rain right now, and it's expected to stop, so those water levels fall pretty quick. Yeah, he does. We have several roads down in town that are gone. They've been washed out completely. So, That's a bummer. Yeah, I'll know. Yeah, I'll know next year. So, right. Do you get hurricanes, Linda? We're on our Tao Te Ching day. And my name's Michelle Wolf. I'm at CaddyshackDesigns.com. And I do Reiki, Desire Map workshops, Young Living Essential Oils, coaching and whatnot, cat planning, cat friendly, house planning. Thanks for the shares and the hearts. I noticed since the update, most of the hearts y'all give actually are counting. Usually misses your itty bitty piece. Good. So, we are on chapter 14 of the Tao. Really loving this book. Been listening to it in the car. Really love that. It's really peaceful. Florida for 8 years, so lots of hurricane stuff there, right? I've never lived on the coast. Well, that sounds terrifying. So, chapter 14 is celebrating mystery in this version. I just realized I have a UPS package coming today. I guess that's not going to get here. Oh well, I don't need it. It's just cat litter. Look at it, nothing to see. Call it colorless. Listen to it, nothing to hear. Call it soundless. Reach for it, nothing to hold. Call it intangible. Triply undifferentiated, it merges into oneness, not bright above and not dark below. Never, oh, never can it be named. It reverts, it returns to unbeing. Call it the form of the unformed, the image of no image. Call it unthinkable thought. Face it, no face. Follow it, no end. Holding fast to the old way, we can live in the present. Mindful of the ancient beginnings, we hold the thread of the Tao. Oh, that's nice. You can't define it. I know. I'm so glad, Nina, that you let us know about this. It's so rich in its imagery. She puts a different kind of rhythm to it that I like. It can never be named. We get into so much trouble trying to put names on source, like God or Goddess or Allah or whatever, you know. What are the other names? We get in a lot of trouble trying to define the undefinable. Because then we start arguing over words and what those words mean and what they should mean, and you should like my words, and I hate your words, and so much trouble. And it's completely wasted effort, because it absolutely can't be defined. I mean, look at how hard a time we have even trying to define love between two people. We can't even get that. It's another undefinable thing. Indefinable. Incomprehensible. Yeah, so why in the world do we think we'd be any more successful trying to define all that is? Yeah. I mean, we do the best we can, right? Because we have to communicate. Well, we don't have to, but we sure like it. I like communicating through certain forums. I should add that disclaimer. But, you know, words are beautiful. It's a double-edged sword, I guess, because your words can be very uplifting and very harming, depending on how you use them. Good morning, Rhonda! And a little coffee back to you. Oh, I'd love to see it. I'd love to see it, Tanya. Oh, that coffee's good. Okay, the next translation is Stephen Mitchell. Stephen Mitchell's translation is not quite as, I don't think it's quite as poetic as Ursula's is. I think hers is a bit more poetic and image rich. They belong somewhere else and only visit here, so why do you worry? Oh, I love that. I love that about kids. They belong somewhere else and only visit here, so why do you worry? That's beautiful. I must have read that section from the book The Prophet a million times, where it talks about how children come through us, but they are not of us. We don't own them. I must have read that 100 times. That Tao, I might have to get Morgan that parenting book, Tao of Parenting book. She might actually read that. So Stephen Mitchell says, oh, that's a great book too. I used it a lot, especially about parenting. I used it less successfully with relationships for a long time. I got it about the parenting. I didn't quite get it about relationships for a very long time. Yeah, I think she would. I think we'll get it for her. You like it, Linda? Okay. So, Stephen Mitchell's book says, look and it can't be seen. Listen and it can't be heard. Reach and it can't be grasped. Above, it isn't bright. Below, it isn't dark. Seamless, unnameable, it returns to the realm of nothing. Form that includes all forms. That's a nice image. Image without an image, subtle beyond all conception. Approach it and there is no beginning. Follow it and there is no end. This is a good line. You can't know it, but you can be it at ease in your own life. Oh, I like that line a lot. You can't know it, but you can be it at ease in your own life. Just realize where you come from. This is the essence of wisdom. That's true. If we remember where we come from, we don't make poor decisions. We don't act on knee-jerk reactions. Holding fast to the old way, we can live in the present, mindful of the ancient beginnings. So I'd have to say that last verse, I like Stephen Mitchell's translation a little better. You can't know it, but you can be it at ease in your own life. Just realize where you come from. This is the essence of wisdom. I like that. I love it. Yeah, Marriott. Hey, Catherine. Coffee hearts. It's really cold here today, too. So let's see what Byron Katie has to say in chapter 14. Her interpretation. We've got three spins on that document, the Tao. Three twists on it. Let's see. Okay. Seamless, unnameable, it returns to the realm of nothing. I tabbed this chapter and I don't remember why, so I guess we'll find out. Ultimately, what is real can't be seen or heard or thought or grasped. You're just seeing your own eyes, hearing your own ears, reacting to the world of your own imagination. It's all created by your mind in the first place. You name it, you create it, you give it meaning upon meaning upon meaning. You add the what to reality, then you add the why. It's all you. The original is wiped out in the wave of the new, which is already old. Thought deletes anything outside ourselves. outside itself. Thought deletes anything outside of itself. So thought, like, obliterates any awareness of the other besides itself. Mind is so powerful that it could take the imagined fist and beat it against a wall and actually believe that you are the person whose fist it is. Because mind in its ignorance is so quick to hold its imagined world together, it has created time and space and everything in it. Mind's ability to create is a beautiful thing, unless, as the terrorist that it often is, it has created a world that's frightening or unkind. She refers to the mind several times as a terrorist, because it holds us, it can hold us hostage and scare the hell out of us with imagined stories and replaying old scary stories. And I mean, it's if you think about what you do to yourself, it's pretty mean. It's pretty mean-hearted, the things that we do to ourselves. But we'll call ourselves kind people. We'll say I'm kind or I'm loving. All the while, we're beating the shit out of ourselves on the inside. That's not kind or loving. We would never treat anyone else that way. Cold. It's cold out here. Can you see my breath? It just fogged. I lost my place. Going on a tangent. Well, it wasn't really a tangent, but mind's ability to create is beautiful unless, as the terrorist it often is, it has created a world that's frightening or unkind. If it has, I would suggest questioning the nightmare. It doesn't matter where mind begins to question itself. It's a tree. Is that true? Or I am. Is that true? The world that mind has created can just as easily be decreated. It goes back to where it came from anyway. Your attachment to it is the only suffering. Your attachment to it is the whole, the sum total, the absolute source of the pain, of the suffering. There's pain and then there's the suffering. And our suffering is located in the mind. Mind can't comprehend nothing. The absolute, that from which everything flows, the original non-world. To name it nothing makes it untrue. It's not nothing, because it's prior to words. Nothing is not only frightening to the world of mirrored thought, it's incomprehensible. Mind becomes frightened when it considers being what it was born from, since that cannot be controlled or known. Without identification as a body, mind is left to die and death never comes for it. What never lived can never die. However, there's hope. And that sounds pretty bleak, right? Eventually, though, mind discovers that it's free, that it's infinitely out of control and infinitely joyful. Eventually, mind falls in love with the unknown, and in that, it can rest. And since it no longer believes what it thinks, it remains always peaceful wherever it is or isn't. Eventually, mind discovers that it can just put it all down and rest and then enjoy whatever's going on at the moment. Just taking it all in, the colors, the sounds, the smells, agreeable and disagreeable. And that is a really restful, relaxing state of being. And eventually, right? When? Can we get some frickin' ETA here? Can you give me a ballpark? What are we talking here? A couple hours? A couple of years? Yeah, can we give ourselves a deadline? By tomorrow at 4 p.m.? Yes, the state of being fully completely present. Yeah, right. Hurry up, Nirvana. I don't have all day. Jeez, I got shit to do. When we reach for it, we push it away. How about now? How about now? It can be now. We're laughing. It is now. We're making fun of ourselves. And that feels good. Are we there yet? That's right. That's what somebody needs to draw up, is a little cartoon of adults in a, on a meditation cushion going, are we there yet? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? Oh, I love that image. Are we there yet? We're always there. That'd be a great t-shirt. Totally would. We're always there. We just forget. Oh, I can't do something like that. I can't draw like that. I can't draw the stuff I see in my head. That's why my drawings are so realistic, because I can only draw what I see. So if I've gotten now to where if I have a really shitty picture I'm trying to draw from, I can kind of fill in the details. But, you know, if I don't see detail, I know the shape. I know how the bones and the muscles lay in the face and stuff like that. So I can kind of estimate. But I can't draw stuff I see in my head out on paper. I've never been able to do that. Extremely rarely. I can draw what I see. And I can replicate it pretty well. But I'm not creative in that way. Hey, Susan. I think that's, like, really an amazing talent. To see an image in your head and not have a reference point and just go and draw it. Thank you. Thank you, Tanya. I do feel like I can replicate things well. I'm just not that kind of artist that can see something in her head and get it out on paper. I really admire people who can do that. But I also like the challenge of replicating details. It's really, true. Yeah, that's true. I probably could if I put the effort into it, but I've got enough. I've got enough. Drawing is a real mindful, fully present activity, because you're so focused on each little line, each little shadow. Can really takes everything else and just takes it away. Meditation in action, I guess. So the very act of reaching for the feather creates the breeze that pushes it away. That, to me, is what this whole concept of the whole book is about, really. But particularly this chapter. By trying to name it, you push it away. By trying to categorize it, you push it away. You push your awareness of it away. You set up a barrier. If you're trying to name something, me too. I might get that tattooed on me somewhere. Take care. Have a great day at work. Thank you. Okay. Have a great work day. I think it's a little bit slow on our end, too. So, try playing with these concepts in a wordless way, whatever that means for you. So that could be, for me, you know, watching the water is like, wow, you know, that's it right there. It's pure power. And it can't be named. The forces that put all those things in motion has no name. And trying to name it limits it. We do have floods. We're already flooded. I mean, we're okay. Our house is up high enough that it's fine. But roads are washed out in town. The schools are closed. They're evacuating people by the river. Two rivers. We have two rivers. But the good news is it's not raining. And they it's not expected to, I mean, it has stopped raining, and it's not expected to start raining again. So, the rivers will crest, they'll fall back down, and they fall back down pretty quick. Our stream is already back now under the bridge, and last night it was completely over it. The washing out stuff in town, or the sound you're hearing is all our creek. Yeah, that's the creek. At the very beginning of the, it's crazy. Last night it was so loud, I'm not even kidding, it was so loud. And the water, it sounded like as if you were standing under a waterfall. Because the rain was super loud, and the creek was actually a river because it was way up, out of its banks up on the property. So it was loud, it was just really loud. So super loud sounds contribute to anxiety for me too, so there was that. And I didn't want to put earplugs in case we got an emergency alert or something. It's under it. It floods here all the time. You would walk through water to your knees to get to class. God! That's amazing. That's amazing. Yeah, it kind of is still. It's probably, I would say on any given day, it's about 5 feet wide, and it's double that, easily. It's easily double that. I'm going to guess right now it's probably about 12 feet across, and really, really deep. It's normally really shallow, like right here. It's, you know, it's deeper in other areas, but right here it's, you know, ankle deep. And it's, yeah, it's beautiful. It's probably, I'm going to guess it's 2 feet deep now. I'm not really great with those kinds of measurements, but I'm trying to imagine if I stood in it, it'd probably be over my knees. Maybe 2 feet. Down by the road is totally underwater. Oh, I hate when that happens. So, but just like everything else, I mean, it peaks out and then it drops off. There's some roads washed out. Nobody's hurt. They close the schools to keep everybody off the roads. There was one accident that I heard of, but, you know, that's not unusual. The roads in town that are completely gone, that's going to be a real pain in the butt for people until they get repaired. But, you know, nobody's hurt. Nobody's house is lost. Or it's not that bad, I guess, on a scale. Just had some anxiety about it last night. But I'm okay now. And like I said, my anxiety was more related to not feeling 100% sure that my husband wouldn't try to drive into that water. Although when I say, you know, I'm serious, this is seriously more than you think it is, don't drive in that water and promise me you won't, then you won't. So after I got the promise out of him, then I was able to go to sleep. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to get a hold of him to squeeze him into a promise until like 2 a.m. Because once he does that, then, you know, I know. As long as he's doing the, yeah, I don't know, yeah, maybe, then he's going to do what he's going to do. But two reasons I didn't want him to drive in that water. First of all, he could die. Second of all, he'd ruin our car, and that's like our one good car. Yeah, I just need to know for certain. And then I guess he could have changed his mind, but he's never done that. So as soon as I got that out of him, I was like, all right. I'm going to go to bed. One of the sections of the road he drives home on is gone. It's washed out. But fortunately for us, it's the opposite direction. So he's able to get home just fine. And they had a nice wet, woodsy hike walk in. So anyway, I don't have a lot. Let's pull a card, shall we? just for fun. I've got them sitting here anyway, and I haven't pulled one yet. This is the one I was going to use today. The Enchanted Map. I like this deck a lot. And since I haven't pulled one anyway, we'll just pull one for all of us. Hey, Amelia. What's up? Yeah, he got home just fine. He just crawled over a mountain with a rose in his teeth. No biggie. Hello. Amelia, we were just talking about my husband. We're flooded here in North Georgia, and the road is underwater, so he had to leave our car. We live out in the woods. And climb up, you know, go down, cross a bigger bridge, go up the mountain, over the mountain, back down the mountain to try and cross one place. Couldn't. Went back up the mountain. It's, like, really steep. Like, we're talking some steep angles. And all the while, he was carrying a rose that he had stopped and bought for me. So, super romantic. I said before he went to bed, I said, you don't really know, I don't think, what this does to a woman when a man does something like that. And he said, oh, I know. And I was like, you planned for getting brownie points? And he was like, I'm not stupid. Excuse me. My cough is almost gone, but when it gets me, it gets me. So the Enchanted Map. Everybody focus while I'm shuffling. Oh, I know. Yeah. He ain't no dummy. He knew that was going to go over well. He can be a charmer when he wants to. Romance. I've heard about that. I've seen that in a couple of movies. He's one of those guys that is, he's not a redneck, but he's mechanical. He's not book smart, as we would say. So his romance stuff is few and far between. So when he does do something, it's like, it gets him more points, because he doesn't do it all the time. Shuffling down here. And when he decides to do something, he does it really well. Like, he does little daily things. Like, he usually will cook breakfast before he goes to bed. That's very nice. I enjoy that. I know that I'm quite spoiled in those areas. He does the laundry. Some of it. Most of it. Alright, this one popped out. So we'll take the popped out one, and then I'll also go ahead and cut the deck. Yeah, it means a lot more when they don't do it all the time. I'm sure that it's just like anything else. Yeah. It's just like anything else. Oh my God, you guys. I have drawn this card 3 times this week, which I'm super happy about. So we'll read them both. We'll assume that there's somebody on here that needs one or both of these. So the one that went flying out while I was shuffling is Strength. She's balancing on one leg, holding the world in a very complicated pose. Number 44, if you have this deck. Let's read it. And it fell out upside down, so let's read both, or we'll just, you know, we'll look. I know, right? Double four. The last 4 digits of my phone number are 4441. I love it. Can't find it in the book. Good Lord. Where are you? Okay. Strength. So somebody on here needs this one, I suspect. Your true strength comes not from self-reliance alone, but from a sincere faith in a higher power. Upright, it says, the strength to accomplish even the most daunting task is yours at this time. You can connect with and channel the power of the universe. The Strength card indicates that your ideas are being tested and refined, and your relationships are being deepened. No matter what happens, nothing can move you off the course of evolution. Yes! Yes! Like your schoolwork, just gotta hang in there. As the potency of your connections becomes more obvious, you're able to harness the creative energies that are available to you. Here's the directions. Have courage and dive in. For magic, ooh, this is good. For magic is so good I can't say it. Have courage and dive in, for magic is in the process of finding a form to take. What wants to happen here? Trust the path and then onward. When you remember that real strength comes from a combination of your efforts and reliance on a higher power working through you, all is possible. You can do anything now. I love that. Oh, we'll skim it over here real quick. Strength. Your true strength comes not from self-reliance alone, but from a sincere faith in a higher power. The strength to accomplish the most daunting task is yours at this time. You can connect with and channel the power of the universe. The Strength card indicates your ideas are being tested, refined, and your relationships are being deepened. No matter what happens, nothing can move you off the course of evolution. As the potency of your connections become more obvious, you're able to harness the creative energies that are available to you. So have courage and dive in, for magic is in the process of finding a form to take. So if you're in that in-between, if things are all tossed up in the air, it's a scary place to be. It's also a really exciting place to be, because if you're in alignment, where the pieces fall is going to make you very happy. When magic is finding a form to take and you're willing to let it take whatever form it takes, I sure can. I can take a picture of it and put it in there. When you're willing to let magic have its way with you, and I mean, by magic, I mean that wonderful connection to love. Love, when you let love take its own form in your life, what it comes up with is astounding, will astound you. Last night, my daughter and I were talking about tattoos. We're getting matching tattoos. And we have an artist that we like, and we both are of the same mindset, that you give the artist, let love take the lead. You give the artist, like, an idea of what you want, like, magic love. You tell the artist, and you can tell the big artist in the sky, the all that is artist, a general idea of what you want, but then you step back and you let the artist do his thing. I love this concept, and because I always get better results when I say, here's kind of what I want. And I might have one or two things that I really need to have. What? He was a tattoo artist for years. Does he still have equipment? I will totally take a garage tattoo from Ben. Yes, and it frustrates the artist when somebody comes in with a picture and says, I want this exact thing. Because there's no room for interpretation. There's no room for personalization. My Phoenix tattoo is a design off the internet that I reinterpreted. Not totally. Oh my gosh, I would totally let him tattoo me. I totally would. You want to take as many limits off as you can, so that you let God and the Source present you with something better than you can imagine. So you our limited minds and our limited frames of reference can't imagine the most glorious things that God could have in store for us. You didn't let him tattoo you, Tanya? It seems that way. If we take the limits off of God, if we take the limits off the artist, what we can get presented with is so much better than we could ever have imagined. Well, you don't know what you're missing, little lady. Oh, you were thinking about tattoos yesterday? Well, get yourself a tattoo from Tanya's husband. Oh, you're a baby about pain. Oh, we're all thinking about tattoos. We should come up with a group tattoo design and all meet in Charlotte and let Ben draw it on us. Okay. So that was the upright version of that card. So Cindy, since it, you feel really strongly attracted to it. Synchronicities, ladies. That's right. We're all in tune with each other. Cindy, I'm going to read the reverse version too, in case there's information in there for you that's helpful. Because it did fall out upside down. When you see the strength card reversed, pay particular attention to your health. For this indicates that your body, mind, and spirit need strength at this time. Exercise, rest, and proper nutrition are necessary to keep you in balance. Don't deplete yourself through overwork, as now is the time for building stamina. Perhaps you feel the bonds weakening in a relationship. Is that it? Because that kind of has a ding-ding to it. They may need repair. Attend to them before the burden of repair gets too heavy. Be strong, face the reality of your relationship at this time, and give it your attention, for any fragile threads may give way. Let go of whatever robs you of your life force, and trust that something better will take its place. So this sounds like one of those kinds of things where awesome confirmation of what you were already picking up. So this card totally fell out for you. This sounds like a relationship that could go either way, almost. Like it's not determined which way it's going to go yet. Like the bonds are weak. It could go to the dust. It could go back to life. Fragile. Yeah. So that's really interesting. So probably a lot of it boils down to, what do you want to do? This is the first one. What do you want to do, Cindy? What do you want it to be or not be? Sometimes when things are in that teetering place of they could go either way, the only thing it's waiting for is a decision to be made by somebody. And you can't make a mistake if you're following your heart. You just can't. Even if it looks like a mistake, it won't turn out to be a mistake if you're following your heart. So the second card, and I will put both of these in the Periscope group. Susan, are you on Facebook? The second card was, kid you not, this is the fourth time I've gotten this card. Oh, darn it. I was just saying, watch the replay, Cindy. I was just talking to you about decisions sometimes need to be made in relationships, and that's all it needs to determine which way it's going to go, is making a choice. And you can't make a wrong choice if you're following your heart. And Susan is saying that she's afraid that if she follows her heart, it's going to be a big mistake. Oh, you're not on Facebook. Okay. Well, I'll hold this up so you can get a screenshot, okay? This is Peaks of Joy. This was the second card for the group. This is a wonderful, wonderful card to get. So if while I was shuffling you were thinking about a specific situation, one of these two cards will give you some information. Peaks of Joy. Screenshot that, and then you'll have it. Number 33. Lovely card. Wonderful card. And it was upright, so. Your life is filled with happiness, so share it with others. Joy is yours today. No matter what your question, you will be happy with the results. You're coming closer to a sense of achievement, Michelle, and you've worked hard for it. You're surrounded by true companions and events that are synchronistically arranged to bring you to the next level of your life. Mic drop. Boom! That's perfect. The world is singing a beautiful harmony. Life is exhilarating and hopeful. You talking to me? Whoa, you talking to me? They are powerful. Well, we're an in-tune group, so the power of the cards is the power of who's focused on them. We're an in-tune group, and synchronicities happen all the time. The world is singing in beautiful harmony. Life is exhilarating and hopeful. Let gratitude fill your heart and remember to share your happiness. Yeah, it is. Joy is contagious. Now, let's read the reverse one, because sometimes, yeah, they do. The two cards really do go together. Good observation. So let's read the reverse in case that information applies. And it could. I'm just guessing. Do you rely too heavily on your material achievements when you assess how happy you are? Perhaps you say, I'll be happy when I meet the right lover, make the right amount of money, reach my ideal weight, blah, blah, blah. Why wait to arrive at the perfect destination before allowing yourself to experience sheer delight? Joy for the sake of joy. Why wait for that to happen, whatever that is, before you're allowing yourself to feel joy? At Susan. This is a day for joy. Take a walk, listen to the songbirds, scratch a kitty's head. You scratch one of the kitty's head around here, you're going to end up with a scratch. Play with a dog, look at a baby, and be in awe of life, which leads to a true sense of bliss. Be alive, be grateful, and know that happiness is an inside job. Oh, unbelievable! It had to be for you. It had to be for you. Your screen froze. Oh my God. You didn't hear any of the reverse part? Is that when it froze up? Replay for sure. Yeah, we were poking at you. Happiness is an inside job. We were teasing you. You have to watch the replay. I'll skim over it real quick. I'll just repeat it real quick, but watch the replay too. Because everyone on here was like, Susan, this one's for Susan. Oh gosh, darn it. Do you rely too heavily on your material achievements when you assess how happy you are? So when you take stock in your life, perhaps you say, I'll be happy when I meet the right lover, make the right amount of money, reach my ideal weight, find the right job, yada yada. Why wait to arrive at the perfect destination before allowing yourself to experience sheer delight? Be happy now. Find the joy now. Celebrate your success now before you can even see it. This is a day for joy. Do whatever it takes to find joy. Whatever it takes to feel happy today. Raising your happiness threshold, yes. Yes, Susan, when we strike out and reach higher, we can bump up against our happiness threshold. We only allow ourselves to feel a certain level of happiness. When we try to reach beyond it, sometimes we sabotage ourselves with anxiety and problems and glitches and things that go wrong. And often just by recognizing it and talking yourself down off the ledge, everything's fine. just by recognizing, you know what? I'm not super comfortable feeling the kind of happiness that I'm reaching for. The kind of happiness that I'm stretching into is not super comfortable yet. That mug... Shit, I'm not connecting. Right, I'm glad you're doing that. Because when you go into the future is when anxiety kicks in. Anticipation is anxiety provoking, producing. It's horrible. I used to tell the kids that I had in counseling when they would start future projecting, oh, you can't go from anger straight to joy. Yeah, there are steps in between, the emotional scale. So, you gotta move into it. Oh, good. Yeah, you can't go from 0 to 60. You can't go from depression to ecstasy. It's a process. So, Susan, when you're reaching for, let's say not reaching, let's say stretching into more of your potential, it's very uncomfortable. And stuff changes. Relationship changes. Sometimes jobs change. Sometimes housing changes. Things change because you've offset the balance. You've upset the previous balance, and you're trying to find your way to a new balance. And that's a real wobbly place to be. Oh, thank you. Yeah, I don't want you to hurt yourself. Don't hurt yourself. Be easy about it. No, sometimes just knowing. Of course you do. That's what doubt is for. Oh, yeah. Susan, can you send me an email so I have your email and I'll send you some stuff? Anybody that wants to can email me. And I'll send you the process of change thing. CaddyshackDesigns@gmail.com. It's looking for my card. Anyway, CaddyshackDesigns@gmail.com. Yes. You need to read The War of Art by Stephen Pressfield and understand the concept of resistance. The better idea you have, the more anxiety you may feel. The more you're stretching into your potential, the more resistance will arise. Sometimes it's a good indicator of how good your idea is to how scary it makes you feel. So, there's that. It's not a bad thing to question new directions in life. Just from a logical perspective, look at what angles you can see, and if you still feel a heart pull to go that direction, then go. Resistance is the normal, absolutely happens every time, counterbalance. Yeah, choices come from either love or fear. You make a choice out of love, and you have that creative impulse, and what follows right on its heels is a bunch of doubt. That's resistance, and that's okay. Pay attention to it, listen to it, acknowledge it, but don't let it stop you. I mean, you got to listen for, is this the right time? Sometimes we have a creative impulse. Oh, and now you regret it? It's okay, it'll come back around. When we miss a boat, another boat comes. And another boat comes, and another boat. If it's truly your path and you miss an opportunity, it's not missed permanently. Something better will come. It wasn't perfect. It was good money but stressful work. Good Lord, I'm glad you turned it down. We'll tell you all about it's never worth taking a job for money. Never. You ain't got time for that. Ain't nobody got time for that. Ain't nobody got time for that. Resistance is normal. Me too. Never, ever, 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 ever. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. Unless you're living in a homeless shelter and you need to find your way to an apartment, it's not worth it. If you got to work at McDonald's to get your ass out of the homeless shelter, fair enough. Or, you know, whatever. Hustle some stereo speakers on the street or whatever. I know, I actually know someone who's done that. Not me. Not anyone in my personal realm, but I know I have an acquaintance. Let's say that. Here's the thing, Susan, you're open to it. When you're open to it, the right thing will come. And in the meantime, you just work with that anxiety. Just let it be. Don't fight it. Don't try to get rid of it. That just makes it bigger. Just breathe around it. Breathe through it. So our reading today said, one of the cards. Which card was it? The strength card that said, let it come through you. Yes. Have courage and dive in, for magic is in the process of finding a form to take. So that sentence, magic is in the process of finding a form to take. That process looks a lot like anxiety and confusion. You're one day closer every day. Anxiety and confusion can fill our mind when magic is in the process of finding the form to take in our lives. The in-between feels really cloudy, and cloudy scares us. The in-between of making a decision and waiting for it to show up. Good morning, Heidi. Heidi's in the in-between, too. You make the decision, okay? Here's the process. You have that creative impulse from spirit. Then you make your decision. You're here right on time. When you make the decision, it takes time. Right, they didn't know I was getting them a banana and they were falling apart. So I have twin granddaughters and they were on my scope one day. They were hungry and so I stepped away from them to go get them a snack. When I stepped away, they just burst into tears, both of them, sitting on the floor, crying their eyes out. I went and got a banana. I came back, tried to give it to them, but their heads were down, and they were crying so loud by then, they couldn't even see it. It was perfect. That's us. We make a decision. I'm hungry. And then the universe has to line shit up for us. The magic has to find a form to take. And in between then, we think nothing's happening. So we're like, well, fuck it. And it was right there. It was literally in front of their little noses. But they wouldn't look at me. They were doing this. Ah! 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 Toddler crying with her eyes tightly shut. Ah! I had the banana like right here. All they had to do was open their eyes. As soon as they opened their eyes, they got their banana. So, you make a decision, I'm hungry. I'll never forget it either. The universe has to go get your banana. Okay? You got to give it a little time. You got to let the universe walk to the kitchen and pick the perfect banana for you. The perfect banana for you. That might take a little time. And then it's going to bring you back that banana. And it's going to bring it back to you a lot faster if you have your eyes open. And your hands. Open hands. You got to have your hands and your eyes open to receive it. That can feel like anxiety and confusion. Amen. Hallelujah. I love bananas. Susan, you're just waiting for your banana. That's all. That's all it is. Just gotta give it time. Our otherworldly creations are instantaneous, but we do live in a physical body and a physical world, and that takes time. Building a business takes time. Building a blog following takes time. Building a Periscope following takes time. You gotta give the universe time to find the people to answer your prayer. We're the answers to each other's prayers. We answer each other's prayers, and some of us say that every day, let me be the answer to someone's prayer. The universe has to find the people who can answer your prayer. They have to find the person to lead you to the job. It's going to come through a person. They have to find the person that's going to send you the job notice. They have to find the person that's going to hand you the newspaper. It comes through people. Okay? It may come through you. The universe has to guide you by creating a traffic delay so that you turn right instead of left. So that you wander over and you see a help wanted sign. Or you decide, screw this traffic, I'm going to stop and have myself a latte. And in the process of having a latte, you talk to somebody in a coffee shop, find yourself a new job. That's how it goes. I try to be. That's how it works. So, wrestling with your anxiety and confusion and your doubts is wasted effort. Just let them be. It's okay. Don't let them have you squint your eyes shut and close your fists. That's when you're lost. You aren't lost forever, but it will delay things. It will create unnecessary delays between the good that's trying to find its way to you. It happens when you let it. It happens when your eyes are open. It happens when your hands are open. It happens when your head is up and you are curious. How's the universe going to make this happen for me? I can't wait. It's exciting. How's the universe going to bring this thing, this situation to me that I know I'm destined for? How's it going to happen? I can't wait to get out in the world today and see who I run across and see who I talk to and see who recommends a book to me or see what song's on the radio when I turn it on. Or see whose conversation I overhear in the checkout line at the grocery store. Does that make sense? The in-between gets us scared and we can shut it all down. We can shut that shit down. If we get too scared. So just understand that it's normal. It's normal. It's not that you're doing something wrong. It's not that you're crazy. It's not that you're completely out in left field. It's normal. Eyes open, hands open, curiosity. Eyes open, hands open, curiosity. You stay in that place and the universe will find the people to bring you your banana. It could end up being bananas Foster or banana cream pie. Something better than a plain old banana. We're not much different than toddlers, are we? Always when I think I've got nothing to say. Yeah, I've been rattling on a bit. Could be a banana split. Could be banana pudding. That's the best. Banana pudding with vanilla wafers. None of this is going to make sense, Roseanne, until you watch the replay. A banana facial. Just don't slip on a banana peel. So hopefully that helps. Thank you. Glad. It wouldn't be bananas anything for me. I'm not a big fan. Yeah, watch the replay. We pulled some cards and then it triggered a whole bunch of other stuff, as it usually does. So, the reading today was, it was alright. But we pulled cards and that got everything going. That was better. A little more productive. We are blessing each other. I'm grateful to Periscope every day that it gives us a place to gather. Where one or more is gathered, right? What would it take for us to get you on Facebook, Susan? And Cynthia. Cynthia's job prevents her from getting on Facebook. Cynthia, if you're watching the replay, we really wish you were on Facebook. Mine either. My day would not be the same. Blessings on all your heads. Blessings on all our heads. Just remember, if you're in the in-between, eyes open, hands open, curiosity. That's a wrap. You're welcome. You're welcome. I love it. I love it when a card falls out of the deck like that, and it's the perfect card. You take your time. Hey, you know what, Susan? Hi, bye, Rosie. Susan, you can make yourself a fake profile. You can go on Facebook and make up something. Yeah, I set my mom up and do all the work on it. You post stuff now, though. Leave comments now. But you can set yourself up a fake one with a fake name. Just let us know who you are. So that you don't have to be out there. And you don't have to let everybody know that you're on Facebook. Exactly. You could do Facebook under another name. That's what we told Cynthia to do. You're welcome. Yes, honey, get rid of that egg. Get rid of that egg. Even if you don't use your face, get rid of that egg. I finally stopped. I used to block everybody that had eggs. And then I realized that because lots of the trolls are just eggheads. But then I realized that some people just don't know how to upload a picture, so I quit. Yeah, don't put in your schools, don't put in your job. Make up a fake location. Say that you live in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. Unless you really do, and that would be bad. Alright, I'm freezing to death. Here comes the wind. So, time to go. Time to go. Thanks for being here. Oh, you hear my bong, bong, bong. See that temple bell back there? Chicago. That temple bell swinging is what's making that bong sound. I got that at the Japanese Gardens in Fort Worth, Texas. Ooh, I love it. All right, my dears. Much love to you if you're in the in-between. Extra blessings on you. Me too. And I'm glad to know this is normal and nothing to worry about. Thank you, Tanya. Dang those floods. Have a great day, my dears. Love you, all of you. And I'll see you tomorrow. You know what? I'm supposed to watch the twins tomorrow. Ooh, I just realized I may not be able to get out. Well, we'll see. The water's dropping. We'll say that the water's going to drop by 4 o'clock in the morning, 5 o'clock in the morning when I have to leave. All right. Love you. This shit is bananas. I'm just waiting on my banana. Nothing to worry about. I'm just waiting on my nanner.